here's our map API. What we need to do is figure out how to draw this map. The URL is going to look like this. It's going to be this URL, maps.googleapis.com/map/api/static map, and then it's going to have some parameters. And I've done a little research already to find that the only required parameters are size, which is going to be the size of the map, sensor, which is whether, if we were doing this on a phone or in a browser that knows where you are already, whether to actually try to figure out where the user is. We're not going to use any of that. And then we can just add these marker parameters. So here's one marker. You can see in here, this marker is defining the color to be blue, and it has a label. And then also we can see something that looks like coordinates in here. I've learned that the color and the label aren't required. So we can just say marker and give it the coordinates. And if you notice here, there's another marker parameter. And the way this API works is it just looks for multiple marker parameters. We'll just add one marker parameter in the URL for each point that we have. Let's go ahead and do that. Now we want to update our front page to actually have the art images. So let's think about what we're going to do. We're going to first find which arts have the coordinates. If we have any arts with coordinates, and we need to display the image URL. First thing we need is we need to find which arts have coordinates. This is fairly easy. What we can do is we're going to take this list of arts, and for each one, we're going to check to see if it has coordinates. So let's say for A in arts, if arts.chords, points.append, A.chords. And we have to define points is equal to the empty list. This is pretty straightforward. For A in arts, for each one of these, if there is coordinates, the way the data store works is if there are not coordinates in the database, this will just be none. It won't blow up on us or anything. Just add it to the list points. This is a clear way of writing it. How I would have written it is slightly less clear, a little shorter. This is just some Python learning for your own edification. Points equals filter none, A dot chords for A in arts. So this is a generator, A dot chords for A in art. This will return an iterator of all the coordinates, which may be either coordinates or none. And then filter takes two parameters. It takes a function, or none, and a list, or an iterable, and basically returns all of the items in the list that match the filter. And in this case, if the filter is none, it basically says match all of the ones that aren't none. This will give us all of the chords for each A in art if it's not none. And that does exactly the same as this. We're going to use the slightly shorter version. This should work. Let's make sure this doesn't blow up on us. Here we are in the browser. We reload the page, and we see our little guys. Maybe we should print out the coordinates so we can see them. Let's go ahead and do that. Okay, so we're going to go ahead and write that out. Let's try that in our browser. There we go. There's a list of our points, and in this case, we only have one, so that's good. There's one subtle bug I'd like to point out to you in this code. Arts is a query. When we iterate over arts, that's when we actually run the query. So if we never iterated over arts here, this query wouldn't run. Well, we iterate over here, and then when we're rendering the front.html, this template, if you recall, has a loop in it that draws all the arts. And this also iterates over that arts query. Each time we do that, we run the query. We don't want to run the query twice. That's wasteful. Not only is it wasteful, the results of that query could change. Whenever you find yourself in a situation of iterating over results you get from a database, whether it's data store or some other kind of cursor-based abstraction from a database, it's usually good to say something like this. And what this does is it creates a new list out of that arts. So the arts that comes out of here is a cursor. And then we basically call the list constructor on it, which says, okay, make a new list out of that iterable. And then we can iterate over this list as many times as we want, and we've kind of detached it from the query. This is a good habit to get into if you think you're going to be using results from the database more than once, or you're going to be manipulating this result from the database kind of too far away from this query. Because generally, if you get a list of things or an iterable, you assume that you can go over it a couple times. That's all this is going to do. It's basically going to cache the results of this query in a list. It's very subtle, and I was actually struggling a little bit how to demonstrate that to you. I don't know how to debug Google queries. If I could have made this print in the console, I would have. And if we figure that out between now and when we wrap this lesson up, we'll include that in the instructor comments, how to show what queries are actually running. But I did a little Googling and confirmed to myself that this would be the case. So anyway, that's good to do.